I'm the bridge between lunch and theme four, where theme four is data. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the promise of new data and advanced analytics. You'd be unsurprised to hear, I'm going to conclude, it's very promising. And there are good reasons for saying that, I think, because I think we are reasonably in the early throes of what is genuinely a revolution. A revolution in information and a revolution in data. Pretty much everything we do these days, pretty much every minute of every day, is generating new data, much of which is being stored. And that includes actually data generated by you at this conference. Let me let you into a secret. So first thing this morning, we attached some sensors to your coffee cups. And using those and the latest voice recognition software, we were able to pick up and monitor the words you were using to describe the Bank of England. From which we can construct a word cloud to capture the key themes from this morning's coffee conversations. So brace yourselves. Not had much chance to look at this myself yet, but here is the word cloud. That was thrown up. Fortunately, most of it's okay. For example, words like research, good. Bank, yeah, even better. Monetary. Weather, obviously, the weather. One or two, it's fair to say, rather more idiosyncratic entries. Here's one, for example, groupthink, some of you talking about that. And this one took my interest. Clueless. Now, I did suspect that Larry Elliott from The Guardian might be in the room, but he's not actually here. So if anyone wants to own up to using those words, I mean, feel free to raise your hands now. If not, don't worry, because we can use that voice recognition software, actually, to link to any YouTube videos you have made and figure out who you are. Now, before any of you start calling for your lawyer, let me tell you a second secret, which is nothing I've said so far is actually true. I made it all up. It would have been deeply unethical to have tapped your conversations. We'll save that for the drinks reception later on. But we could have done it. At almost no cost. And let me give you a second example, which is real, of a place where we have used, in this case, social media, to help our understanding of what goes on in economic and social systems. It's a recent example. It's from the Scottish referendum. You remember back then, there were legitimate concerns that there could be deposit flight from financial institutions that could have been fanned by social media. So we set up at that point, Charlotte's idea actually, a semantic system for monitoring tweets that contained words with the following three ingredients: Scottish institutions, referenda, and panic or run. And we tracked those tweets on an hourly basis in the period running up to the referendum date. This is what the picture looks like. This is what we were looking at the time. As you can see, not much happened, and thank heavens for that. But had it spiked, we would have had, I hope, some early indication of panic, social media-induced panic and potential deposit flight. This system could not have been put in place as recently as 5 years ago. Second example, another social media example. We've looked at the tweets and retweets that accompany our publication of certain material. For example, quarterly bulletin articles. Could draw pictures of who it is that is tweeting and retweeting our stuff, a sort of map of influencers. Here is one of, this is the first time I've seen this chart, by the way. It was replaced about half an hour ago by Emma here. It had names on previously, but we thought that was a bit risky, as some of the names are actually in the audience. So this is, the big green thing is us. All the rest is you, basically. And I won't name names, but Tim, you're red. And this sort of thing can be used, I think, for helping us understand how best to target some of our media. So, back to the essay question. The promise of new data for economics and for economic policy. What we today call macroeconomic data actually has a surprisingly short history. So it's a little over 80 years in 1933 that this man here on the left, Albert Ross Eckler, produced a weighted index of six series, things like railway receipts and imports and coal and pig iron production. And in so doing, created the first ever primitive measure of what we now call GDP. Eckler's aim in doing that was, of course, to understand the depth of the Great Depression. The following year, in 1934, the man on the right, Simon Kuznets, formalized that concept of GDP in a report to the US Congress. And the rest, as they say, is a history. Kuznets and Eckler very much had a hit on their hands. And for all its faults, which are now pretty well understood and well documented, GDP has since spread far and wide. Pretty much every country on the planet now produces a measure of gross domestic product. Some brave souls have constructed GDP estimates, unbelievably, right back to 1 million BC, the dawn of man. Who would like to see a picture, please say yes, of GDP back to 1 million BC? Thank you, sir, madam. Here it is. It's really not very interesting at all. See? Not much happened. But, you know, there's ways of visualizing this which are more interesting. Here's one. Here's a time clock. Here's a time clock. So imagine the history of growth were a 24-hour clock. Then 99% of that growth would have come in the final 20 seconds of human history. The growth revolution. If you think that's impressive, it's as nothing by comparison with the information revolution that I mentioned at the beginning. Let's do the same clock, not for growth, but for information, actually using some of Victor's data. If you ask the question, 99% of the growth in information has come over what period in human history? The answer is 1 or 2 seconds. And while the growth in economic and financial data hasn't been quite as rapid as that, it has still been rapid, very rapid, over the course of the last 10 years, along the three V's, variety, velocity, and volume. And in a second, I'm going to give some examples of economic and financial data falling into one of those three categories. Before doing that, though, I wanted to digress for a second on why it is new data might be so promising. If this was only about more data, better founded empirical stories, that would be good news. But for me, at least, the stakes are actually rather higher than that. The prospective benefits are certainly empirical, but may also be methodological. For much of the past 50 years, economics has had a clear pecking order, methodology-wise. at the top of the pecking order have been so-called deductive approaches to carrying out the economics profession. In other words, take a theory, take it to the data, and test the predictions of that theory. That approach, that deductive approach, as many of you will know, can be traced back to this man on the left, Karl Popper, after the Second World War. And Popper's deductive paradigm replaced what had previously been a classical inductive approach, which had placed correlation, if you like, somewhat ahead of causation in making sense of the wider world. Under Popper's influence, that flipped around. Causality came to replace correlation as a scientific standard. Testable predictions came to replace stylized facts as the way we went about our business. And the economics profession very much took Popper's message to heart. Among economists, of which there are a number here, no crime is more heinous than data mining, right? That is to place empirics way ahead of theory. It's putting the tail before the donkey. And that deductive levity lives on, including here in this building, right? So if I had a pound for every time someone in this building had said to me, you know what, Andy, it depends on the shock. It depends on the shock. And the thing is, guess what? In many complex systems, it really doesn't. It really doesn't. Often in complex systems, the shock is the least interesting and least important feature of the data in making sense of the dynamics. The precise flap of that particular butterfly's wing isn't super interesting for understanding what causes the hurricane, in much the same way as someone said earlier on today, that the subprime crisis by itself is not super informative for understanding the scale and complexity of the global financial crisis that followed from it. In that complex world, correlation may be just as useful for making sense of the world as causal chains and testable predictions. And the man on the right here, Hal Varian, who's the chief economist at Google, in some ways has taken that on in using Google search engines to extract measures of correlation to make sense of the macroeconomy. I'll show you a few of those in a second. In most of the professions, data mining is not a heinous crime. In many of them, it's an empirical necessity. In some of them, it's an absolute goldmine. And that's why those inductive approaches increasingly have been in the ascendancy across many of what you might call the hard sciences. And I think where they have led, there is the opportunity at least for economics now to follow. This is not the end of theory, but could it mean a rebalancing of the methodological scales as between inductive and deductive approaches? I think prospectively, yes. So let's turn back to some data, some empirics, and let me show you some pictures. Because as Mark mentioned at the beginning, the bank is making available today a set of data, some of it new, which we hope will catalyze research, not just inside the bank, but as a more importantly, outside the bank as well. Let me take on a quick Cook's tour of some of those pieces of data and how they could be made to sing. Some history data, some survey data, some microeconomic data, some semantic data, each of which I think has some virtue in helping us make sense of economics and economic policy. Let me start with some history data. Because we're making available today clutch of economic and financial data stretching back over the whole history of the bank, more than three centuries. One of the great issues of today, one of the great puzzles, is the so-called productivity puzzle. Why has productivity been so weak during the course of the recovery? As this picture from 1850 shows, productivity, give or take, has been on a relentlessly rising path up until the last six or 7 years. But here's where history can help. Because if you go back far enough, perhaps this is not so much of a puzzle after all. Let's take productivity back to 1 AD. Over that longer window, we went through about 1500 years prior to the Industrial Revolution when productivity was more or less flat. It wasn't the exception, it was pretty much the rule over much of that period. Why was that? You'll have stories. Might that hold any insights for what's happening today? Maybe so, maybe so. Over to you. One of the consequences of that weak productivity, again over recent years, is that wage growth has been quite weak. That's shown here on the left-hand side picture, which is average weekly earnings growth. It's been a low number for several years now, despite the fact that the labour market here in the UK has been tightening. That's the right-hand side picture. Unemployment has fallen precipitately. These are both official sources of data drawn from large samples using standard surveying techniques. For example, at the left-hand side picture, that's wages. That's drawn from a sample of around 9,000 firms, covering around almost 14 million employees, right? But maybe, just maybe, there are shortcut ways of extracting some of the essence of those trends, developments in the labour market. Imagine, instead of surveying those thousands of firms, we simply typed salaries into Google and plotted the number of search hits over time. What you'd get is the yellow line. It's not perfect, but nor is it terrible. If you instead didn't count the number of people out of work, but instead typed job seekers allowance into Google and plotted searches over time, you'd get that line, which is even better. Now, my point here is not to add to the unemployment registry all statisticians, not least because John is here and he's a friend of mine. Not at all. Merely to point out that new sources of data, perhaps noisier, but also cheaper, and in some cases more timely, may have an increasing role to play in making sense of what is going on. And indeed, that is already the case here at the bank, and indeed at the ONS as well, where we're using this type of stuff to make sense of the past, the present, and in some cases, the future. Backcasting, nowcasting, and forecasting using Google type stuff. Now, an alternative window on wage behavior is provided by formal surveys, the like of which the bank's regional agencies, we dotted around the country, have been conducting for several years now. And the bank today is making available for the first time and suitably anonymized the individual responses from those agent survey questions available for researchers. Questions on output, questions on employment, questions on wages. And our hope in making that available is that those new series will help us and you address some of the biggest questions policy-wise that are out there right now. Among the biggest questions right now is what will happen to wages? As slack tightens, will what we call the Phillips curve reassert itself, or has that Phillips curve flattened? Well, here's a picture drawn from the agent's surveys that suggests there is some evidence so far, at least, of the Phillips curve having flattened. The red here is the earlier period, the blue is the more recent period, the line is flatter. But there's huge amounts, we think, huge amounts more that could be done with this database we have just made available. Now, as and when wage growth does pick up in here in the UK, that will start to beg all sorts of questions about what happens to interest rates. And also, what happens to the economy as and when interest rates do begin to rise. And that's a question, of course, to which we've given a lot of thought, and indeed, a question to which we put in place an annual survey of households, more than 6,000 households, to understand their financial position and indeed how they might be affected by a rate rise when it comes. That data too is available on the bank's website. It can be used to answer all sorts of questions, including the impact of those rate rises on different cohorts of households. Savers versus borrowers. Rich versus poor. North versus South. Old versus young. For example, this chart looks at some of those responses. Left-hand side looks at savers versus borrowers. Right-hand side cuts it not by borrowers or savers, but by age. The differences here are pretty striking. They're very significant, as perhaps you would expect. The blue is the sort of raw cash flow effect of rate changes. The red is the behavioral response that households expect to make as rates change, the cut in spending they might make as rates change. We can take this very detailed distributional data, of course, and aggregate it up to get some sense of how the economy in aggregate might perform when the fateful day comes. And that's what this picture shows. An estimate built up from micro ingredients about what a rate rise of different sizes might have on mortgages. If you like, it's a dynamic measure, not a static, not a fixed, not a deterministic, a dynamic measure of the monetary policy multiplier. One we can and indeed have update over time as the distribution of debts and incomes in the economy change over time. Now, micro data like this is useful not just for monetary policy, but for our regulatory tools as well, particularly our macro prudential tools. For example, what we do in the housing market. Over the past 18 months, the bank has been making pretty extensive use of a new database, one that the FCA, the Financial Conduct Authority, have had for the last 10 years or so, which is on a loan-by-loan database of all mortgages granted over the last 10 years. It's a very granular picture of who is borrowing and what their financial position is. Over 13 million financial transactions since 2005. That can be used to do all sorts of things. For example, this looks at different cohorts of households, their mortgage debt to income ratios, and how they've evolved over the most recent period. We can take these data and combine them, as we have, with land registry data to build a regional picture of where the key pockets of indebtedness might be in the UK. And let me show you a little movie of how those pockets of indebtedness have changed over the course of the last few years. So watch the picture and cross your fingers and hope it works. So this movie shows the evolution of high leverage mortgages, more than 4.5 times income on a regional basis since 2008. Warmer colors It's just a higher fraction of loans at or above that 4.5% multiple. What you see is a gradual heating up, especially over the last few years, with a clear epicenter around London and the southeast. I've stopped it halfway through last year because that was the point at which our Financial Policy Committee decided to take some action on just this measure, right? So they decided that they would place some limits, 15% limits, look at the scale on the bottom, on mortgages above a multiple of 4.5%. Look at the title at the top. In other words, that intervention in the middle of last year, that calibration wasn't arbitrary. That calibration was informed by just this database, bringing very granular micro data to bear to frame a macroprudential intervention, in this case, in the housing market. Now, housing is one source of systemic risk. It is by no means the only. Financial markets, as we all now know, are plainly another. It's increasingly widely accepted, and others made the point this morning more eloquently than me, that those financial markets often do really strange things. You cannot make sense of some of the prices by using the conventional components like cash flows and risk premia. You need other stuff. Stuff like risk appetite and sentiment and emotion. I'm looking at David Tuckett in the audience here, who's done work on just this. David, a very eminent psychologist, who's looked at the emotional dimension of finance. But of course, that poses an immediate measurement problem, because we're quite good at measuring cash flows and profits, and not very good at measuring emotions, as economists, you'll have spotted. How to do it? Well, semantic analysis, in other words, using the words people speak to understand their behavior, their emotions, is one way into it. And indeed, that's something we at the bank, working with David and other colleagues, have worked on over the course of the last few years. We've used some of the bank's own internal market reports, the words we used in those, to try and make sense of sentiment in financial markets generally. Let me tell you, let me confess up front. When David first told me he's going to use internal bank documents, which are drafted to within an inch of their life, to understand mood swings in financial markets, I was just a touch skeptical that this would work. But it turns out he was right, and I was wrong, and this picture says why. This plots a semantic measure of anxiety and excitement from internal bank documents against a measure of sentiment in external financial markets, the VIX will be familiar to some of you, and it does show a pretty striking correlation. And we could, and indeed have, where's Michael McMahon? There he is. With Michael, applied similar such semantic analysis to other stuff. For example, the minutes of MPC meetings. That can be used to gauge what is it that was driving behavior, sentiment, in the policy committees. This chart takes the minutes over the last 18 years and looks at how often they used expressions around banking. The answer is, not sufficiently prior to the crisis, I'd say. It's only really just before and most likely just after Northern Rock that banking really entered the bloodstream of the MPC. And therein lies a lesson I hope we've learnt looking at the pattern after that point. Now, it could be argued, look, these are just correlations. They may well prove ephemeral, and that is possibly true. How can these possibly be a substitute for theory? How can we base policy or predictions on them? And in some cases, I think that's a fair cop. But in other cases, I think it's not. I think there are examples where pure correlations are capable of exposing some deep questions, some deep theoretical questions, and some deep policy questions, some of which Hyun and Ricardo actually raised this morning. Let me show you some correlations that speak to just that. This chart is a heat map of correlations between yield curves, interest rates along the term structure, in the UK, the US, and Germany, across time, measured horizontally, and at different maturities, measured vertically. Warmer colors here again signal higher correlations. And I think for me, the remarkable thing about this picture is really just how strong those correlations have become over recent years. More than 90% at every maturity, other than those at around the 6 month to 1 year horizon. Yield curves increasingly are dancing to a common tune, a global factor of some type. What is that? What is that global factor? Is it sentiment? Is it risk appetite? Is it spillovers, cross-border spillovers between countries? Is it something else we haven't thought of yet? Well, suffice to say, our existing theoretical models are really struggling, I think, to make sense of correlations like these, and indeed to make sense of similar correlations between not safe rates, but between risk premia. Our models currently are ill-equipped to make sense of correlations on this scale. And what's true of theory is true also of policy. As policymakers, what do we make of this? It appears to be saying that shocks to global sentiment, global factors, are every bit indeed more important than national factors in driving behavior, behavior both financial and economic. So whether monetary policy, whether macroprudential policy, if it is taking place on a national basis when the real action is happening globally. Correlations may well not be the new causality, but nonetheless, examples like this suggest they could be a timely prompt for a rethink, not just of theory, but of policy as well. Let me wind up. A lot more can, and I hope is, going to be done with these data and the others we are making available today. Mark mentioned at the outset, we're launching a visualization competition externally to try and catalyze action on just these and other questions. I hope some of what I've said encourages you to pick up the baton on each of those. The promise of this new data for policy, for theory, for economics is for me very considerable. And I hope you'll help us join the dots in the period ahead. For those wanting to, here is the web address where those data sets are held. Let me stop here. Thanks very much.